the uncomfortable and the unfamiliar. And we're in Hebrews 11. We're going to start at verse 8. We read this earlier. And we're going to just break this down a little bit. Now, does anybody know that Abraham was the smartest guy in the Bible? Did anybody know that? Because he knew a lot. I got a million of them, folks. I'm here all week. Okay. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to the place he would receive as an inheritance. He went out not knowing where he was going. He went out not knowing where he is going. I'm going to send you to a place where I'm not going to tell you. Just leave your comfortable surroundings. Just leave everything you know. You're no spring chicken. You're 75 years old, but I'm going to ask you just to pack up and leave. But Lord, I'm prosperous. I've got all kinds of herds and cattle. My dad's an esteemed man in this town. Where you? Can you just give me a few more details where you're going to send me? And he's like, no, I'll tell you later. Just go. So two things we learn from this. Obedience takes faith, right? Like I love a guy named A.W. Tozer. You probably heard of him. But he said this, faith and obedience are two sides of the same coin. They're two sides of the same coin. They go together like peanut butter and jelly. He didn't say that. Number one, obedience takes faith. And number two, you will not get all the details you need before you obey. Okay? You just don't get all the details. I remember I was in a really just a bad situation, and I didn't want to leave because I had always learned this, that you never leave a certain ministry until you've got your plan for the new ministry. And so I just didn't feel comfortable changing my family out of this old ministry to the new ministry. And I was at a big Promise Keepers event, and the Lord was going, I want you to move your family. And I'm like, but I recite this Christian saying to the Lord, but Lord, you know that you never move somebody out of a situation until you give them a situation to go. You know that, Lord. You don't give somebody get rid of their old situation until they have a new situation. And he said, I never gave Abraham that privilege. I never gave Abraham that privilege. And so I said, okay, you got me, Lord. But you know, there's a lot of Christian sayings that aren't biblical. Do you know that? That's not a true saying, that you never go until you've got a place to go. Sometimes you just have to go in by faith, and you don't get all the details. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to the place that he would receive as an inheritance, and he went out not knowing where he was going. By faith, he dwelt in the land of promise as in a foreign country, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise, for he waited for the city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Now, when he went to the land of Canaan, guess what? It wasn't developed yet. It still had Canaanites on there. It still had enemies in the land, right? And he went from the archaeological findings they found in Haran, where you probably know all about this, Brian, but they found that city was very elaborate with its foundations and with its buildings. It was very well developed. It was a prosperous city. They even had this ancient form of air conditioning on the nice houses. I don't know how they did that, but this is what archaeology has found. This is what Abraham was used to for 75 years. How many know by the time you're 75, you kind of get set in your ways? None of you young people would know that, but I like my creature comforts more and more every year. I hate Minnesota more and more every year too. God bless Minnesota, but that cold starts getting to your bones. But so this is what he was used to, and now he's like camping on somebody else's land. And he has this promise that you're going to be this great nation, that this is going to be the promised land. Everything that you see is going to be yours, but you're just a stranger. You're just a pilgrim. It doesn't make sense to you. The foundational thing was very real to Abraham. He realized when he was putting in his tent pegs that he did not have foundations wherever they were camping. How many know that camping is not the same as being at home? And so he's got this huge promise, and all he's got is a campsite. All these guys, why were they in the Hall of Faith? Not just because they had a flash of faith, I'm going to do this thing for God, it's going to be big, and then I'll go back to my own life. These guys persevered in faith year after year after year, their whole life. And so now he's got this huge promise, but he's left all his creature comforts, and now he's camping with enemies all around. I remember one night, my buddies and I, we were being stupid. We were probably imbibing on things we shouldn't have. And we were like, let's go camping. And like, okay, where do we camp? I believe that if we go far enough north, we're just going to find open land. And we can just camp there, just on the land. So we did, like it was going for midnight, and we just started driving north and north and north. Well, back in the day, maybe you could find some open land to camp on, but now it's all farms. And the farther we got, everything was still fenced and everything, and we had to stop. And we found some land that it was obviously somebody else's, because we could see a light on their house off in the distance, but we had to camp. So we just parked ourselves on that land anyway. And I remember not sleeping all night, knowing that I was on somebody else's land and afraid that he was going to come out there with a shotgun. I think Abraham felt the same way when they were in the land of Canaan. And they were trying to have peace and trying to have their campsite, but they were invaders and they were intruders. This is before the Israelites had been slaves for 400 years, and they came out and they conquered the land of Canaan. He's just camping out. And so number one point from that is faith will put you into the realm of the unfamiliar. Faith will put you into the realm of the unfamiliar. If you love the familiar, if you can't have anything but the familiar, you're not going to step out in faith. And number two, faith will put you into the realm of the uncomfortable. Faith will put you into the realm of uncomfortable. It was not comfortable to be camping among the Canaanites and the Sodomites and the Gomorrites. Is that a word? That's where they were, man. They weren't in friendly territory. Matter of fact, remember Lot got kidnapped and taken over by some of the tribes there, and Abraham had to muster up some of his own men and go rescue him? It was hostile territory they were camping in. But here's the good thing, because he said that they were waiting for a city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Number three, faith will enable you to look past the unfamiliar and uncomfortable and hope in the future. Faith is not necessarily for your current situation. Your current situation can be whatever it will, but faith puts you out there where your promise is. And look at Colossians 3:1. If then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is, sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on the things of this earth. For you died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, appears, you will appear also with him in glory. I see people believers, way too caught up in their present situation in this world, or even competing with their neighbors for the biggest house, biggest car, whatever. This is not our home, folks. We look for a city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Right? Amen. Amen. That's the Bible. How can I go wrong? Number 11, by faith, Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed And she bore a child when she was past the age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. Now, why is Sarah in the hall of faith? What did she do when she got her prophetic word that she was going to have a kid? She laughed, right? Let's read it in Genesis 18:9. Then they said to him, "Where is Sarah, your wife?" This is the three angels, one of which I believe was incarnate Jesus, like Melchizedek. And so they're there, and they said, "Where's your wife?" "Here in the tent." And he said, "I will certainly return to you according to the time of life, and behold, Sarah, your wife, shall have a son." Sarah was listening in the tent door, which was behind him. Now Sarah... where was it? Oh yeah, now Abraham and Sarah were old, well advanced in years. He was actually 99 and she was 90. How many know they probably were not active? Okay. And so they were that sweet old couple you see at the diner, you know. I remember before I was even saved, I was on a motorcycle trip out in Colorado, and I saw this old couple, totally gray at the diner, and they were just engaged in conversation. And I'm like, I want that. I want that, you know. And so they were happy. They weren't, you know, like I said, they probably weren't too active at that time, but... Sarah, so now Abraham and Sarah were old, well past in advanced in age, and Sarah had passed the age of childbearing. Therefore, Sarah laughed within herself, saying, "After I've grown old, shall I have pleasure, my Lord being old also?" And the Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh, saying, 'Surely shall I surely bear a child since I am old?' Is anything too hard for the Lord? At the appointed time, I will return according to the time of life, and Sarah will have a son." But Sarah denied it, saying, "I did not laugh," for she was afraid. And he said, "No, but you did laugh." And she's like, "No, I didn't." And he's like, "The Lord said, 'Yes, you did.'" She said, "No, I didn't." Yeah, I don't know how long this went on, but she was not really receiving the word of the Lord. But then it says, she... You know, she didn't have a good start. She was laughing at the prophetic word, but then she came to her senses and she judged him faithful who had promised. So my next point is, faith gets our eyes off our abilities and onto God's abilities. Some of the things God calls us to can almost seem laughable, but then you got to reconsider, this is God we're talking about, and God really equalizes the equation. When he asks us weaklings to do certain things with God, nothing is impossible. Amen? And so, verse 12, "Therefore, from one man, and him as good as dead," 2 days from dirt, some guys say, "him as good as dead, were born as many of the stars in the sky in multitude, innumerable as the sand which is by the seashore." Now, that's a figure of speech. Have you ever seen the sand on the ocean? There's not that many Israelites. Have you ever seen the stars in the sky when you're up north in the Milky Way galaxy? There's not that many Israelites, but you can't count them, and you can't count all the Israelites that came from Abraham and Sarah, and that's pretty awesome. Amen? They're innumerable. But it came through what? This woman who laughed at her prophecy, and this guy that was as good as dead. It says that's what the Bible's testimony of. It says, "I was in the Bible. What does it say about you?" "I'm as good as dead," right? But with God, nothing's impossible. And so, so how did this happen? It's because God's promises are based on his strength and not our weaknesses. That's how that's possible. These all, verse 13, "these all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and what? they confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. Everything that we have in faith is connected to our confession. You can't even get saved without confessing Jesus is Lord, right? And so if you're believing something, you need to confess it. You get hung by your tongue, right? And that takes guts. To be in God's secret service takes no guts. But to say, I'm believing God for 200 members in this church. People look around after a while and they're like, what was that confession of yours? And you're like, I'm believing God for 200 members in this church. And they're like, I don't see him. Well, we're not going by sight now, are we? We're going by faith. What are you believing for? I said this last week. We are believers and we believe. If you believe for nothing, you'll get it every single time. What are we believing for? Huh? Are you believing for a restoration of a family member or a salvation of a family member? It can be anything that you're believing for. Might be a improvement in your living situation or a mate or whatever it is. Begin to confess it. I'm believing God for this. I'm believing God for that. It honors him because what are you doing? You're testifying that God's able. What if Abraham would have went around and was like, I mean, I think he probably did this. I'm believing God for a natural born child. Dude, you are 99 years old. Nothing's impossible with God. Nothing's impossible with God. We got to remember that. Is this okay? Okay. I'm not fiery today, but it's all true. So 13 goes on, speaking of all these that we talked about before, these all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them and confessed them that were stranger, they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. For those who say such things declare plainly that they seek a homeland. And truly, if they had called to mind that country from which they had come out, they would have had opportunity to return. They cut off the old. They cut off the old. What did Jesus say? Luke 9:62. But Jesus said to him, no one having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. Okay? When we decide that we're going to pursue God, it doesn't matter what gets left behind. And they were seeking a homeland, it says. Do you know that, I wrote this, often people's sentimentality to return to their homeland is a desire to be with familiar spirits. That might be a hard saying, but there's so many sentimentalities about going home. But you know, sometimes we have to leave even those great feelings of home behind. There was a guy Anna was listening to yesterday that had went to heaven. And I don't put a lot of weight on people that go to heaven and hell, right? Because what did Jesus tell the rich guy that said, if I could just go back and tell them, then they'd get saved. And what did Jesus tell that guy? They got Moses and the prophets. They have everything they need. So I don't think somebody that says they went there necessarily trumps the Bible or augments the Bible. Sometimes they're just making stuff up. One of those guys that they made a movie about, a kid that did that, and he finally confessed that he was making it all up. You got a funny face, but that's the truth. Me and Anna try and steer each other with our faces. So testimonies are great as far as they go, but we have the word of God, right? But this guy said, and I kind of concur with him, he said one of the things that he experienced when he was in heaven, that he just had such a feeling of being home. He couldn't even describe it, but it was just this overwhelming feeling that he had gotten to where he belonged. He'd gotten to his destiny. He had gotten to his home. And I believe that's true because didn't Jesus say, I go to prepare a place for you so where I am you can be also? And why heaven is so much our home is because that's where God is. That's where our Father is, right? Your home is where your parents are, and God's our Father, and we're going to get there someday. But why, you know, there's such an affinity for the old and for the earth, but our origin is not in our mother's womb, right? Our origin is in the mind of God. Before you were in your mother's womb, I knew you, right? Isn't that what the Bible says? So that's why when we're with God again, we are so home. So heaven is our true place of origin. When you pursue God, heaven becomes your home and your final destination. Abraham and Sarah put aside the past and the familiar to believe God's promises for the future. Verse 16, now they desire a better, that is, a heavenly country. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. God showcases all these people in the hall of faith, not because they were perfect, but because they trusted in him. Right? James 1, 2. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience, but let patience have its perfect work that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. The development of faith through every kind of adversity develops friendship with God. How many know when we're going through hard? I'd like to say I pray a lot when everything's going smoothly, but when you have hardship and adversity, you're crying out to God more than ever. Like this Johnny was talking about, I'm crying out for healing every single day. I want to get out of this body. She's been like that for 50 years, calling out to God. But she goes, the cool thing is, I really developed a friendship with God. And that's like Abraham too. He was called the friend of God. His life, to look at his life, is like, you traded your awesome life in Haran. You're the son of one of the richest guys. You've got cattle, sheep, land. You've got influence. You traded that to go camping in enemy territory, right? But guess what he did have? He had adversity, but he came out with the testimony that he was a friend of God. Hallelujah. Much more valuable, especially eternally, much more valuable than having some stuff down here. Amen? I'm just going to read this scripture in John 14, 1. This is an awesome promise. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you're going, and how can we know the way? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. We don't need a road map. Jesus is the way, right? He's the way and the truth. And, you know, like Pilate asked, what is truth? Jesus is saying, I am the truth. We don't need perfect theology. We need Jesus, right? He's the truth. We don't need a lot of vitamin D. You know, we don't need the perfect vitamin combination for life. He is the life. When we're connected to the vine, we're going to bear fruit, right? We're going to have the way, the truth, and the life. And so I'm going to just hit 3 points in review. Number one, don't expect the details. Number one is don't expect the details. Just obey God, right? Just obey God. He'll give you more of the details later, but It's not Bible, but I think it's actually Confucius or something, but he said that the longest journey begins with the first step, right? And that's how faith works too. God talks to you about doing something, don't pray about it indefinitely. Start obeying. Like I said last week, I love what Tom said. I'm not afraid of making mistakes because God can fix those. I'm afraid of being lazy. And too often we mask being lazy with I'll pray about it, right? Or here's the lie Christians always say to one another. We got to get together. Yeah, let's do that. They never do. They never do. Okay, so don't expect all of the details. Just step out in faith. Number two, look past the uncomfortable and the unfamiliar to the eternal. When you step out in faith, it might get uncomfortable. It will be unfamiliar. But you know what? We're not just living for our situation right now. Amen? And then number three, cultivate your relationship with God through the uncomfortable and unfamiliar. You step in out in faith and it gets uncomfortable and unfamiliar, you're going to have to cry out to God all the more. Amen? Amen. Thank you, Lord. Father, I thank you for your word. And I pray that you would enable us to be hearers and doers of the word. Not hearers only, but doers. And God, we don't want to just ask you indefinitely for things when we haven't done what you've already told us to do. Help us to be obedient children. We want to obey by faith. We want to step out in faith. Help us not to be bound by the familiar and bound by the comfortable, Lord. Help us to be willing to go beyond those things. And Lord, help us to be eternally minded, like you said, to set our affections on things above and not on the things of this earth. Amen.